So I recently ran a poll asking what you think I should cover next. Many wanted me to talk about The Man Who Fell to Earth, and understandably so. It's the film where David Bowie shows off his, Bowie.
You know too much about me.
But we'll have to save that and the other two for another day because it was so closely tied with the cult classic where a guy becomes a metal abomination and shows off his very large power drill. Must have been all the Viagra. Tetsuo the Iron Man is the sickest movie that ever movied, and I kind of love it a lot, even if it's really disorienting. Content warning, I don't typically do this, but the rest of this video is going to feature scenes from what can only be described as sensory overload, the extended music video. Rapid cutting, occasional flickering lights, you know, that kind of thing. Also, the content I'll be discussing will be pretty weird and gross, so
what else is new?
Honestly, if you want to turn back now, I don't blame you. Clocking in at only a little over an hour, shot guerrilla style on a shoestring budget with a tight crew that dealt with several creative disagreements and walkouts, Tetsuo the Iron Man is a black and white industrial, provocative, artsploitation, live action, stop motion, hybrid nightmare. It was not only directed by, but also written, produced, edited, and starring the legendary filmmaker of the Japanese cyberpunk movement, Shinya Tsukamoto. Japanese cyberpunk, not to be confused with Western cyberpunk, a part of the genre that is more focused on futuristic high tech, such as artificial intelligence, often set in a dystopian world with themes involving societal decay and the end of humanity. Unsurprisingly, after developing an underground audience throughout the 80s, the height of the movement in the mainstream eye came in the 90s and early 2000s, due to the technological research and achievements like the internet. Despite the cost, more people were buying mobile phones, owning a personal home computer was quickly becoming the norm, which was great because dial-up made it sound like you were connecting to Martians. We were quickly becoming one with technology, and very soon technology will become one of us. For better and slightly for worse. But hey, it's always nice to look on the bright side. Unfortunately, at this moment, I'm not sure where that is. Bummer. When it comes to Japanese cyberpunk, the genre is similar-ish. However, there tends to be a greater focus on body horror, mutations, and monstrous transformations, influenced by a Cronenbergian style. They're often set in an industrialized world, lean more into surreal, abstract ideas, fever dream-induced images, and an overall experimental design and sound. Something that can most definitely be said for Tetsuo the Iron Man, I can tell you that much. The overall style, lighting, and special effects done for Tetsuo the Iron Man are very impressive, for what was a total budget of around $20,000, and also because they too were done by Tsukamoto. The joys of having limited resources. It's important to have multiple talents. Every penny, or I guess every yen, counts. However, the most fascinating element to factor in is that this movie was made so early into his career. Before this, he made a handful of 8mm amateur shorts throughout the 70s and 80s, as well as directed commercials at a production company he worked for after graduating, a stable job his father was more accepting of. It took him a bit to find confidence as an independent filmmaker, recalling that spending several grueling hours a day working for the man as a corporate employee helped influence the themes and concepts of man becomes the machine more present in his projects, such as the frantic, highly energetic sci-fi horror comedy Electric Rod Boy, and primarily The Phantom of Regular Size, which felt more like a rough draft that Tsukamoto would later develop and expand upon when writing Tetsuo. Now, apart from that, the plot is pretty straightforward. There isn't much dialogue between characters who remain nameless, though of course being art house, in the vein of David Lynch's Eraserhead, it does have a fair share of twists and turns. Like a 67-minute roller coaster ride jolting you around, constantly finding new and interesting ways to surprise you from start to finish. And it's never even close to boring, which is kind of amazing. Tetsuo the Iron Man begins and instantly smacks you in the face with ultra-violence, and doesn't slow down from there. Think of the slowest, most meandering film you've ever seen, and well, This is the opposite of that. We're introduced to a guy with a metal fetish who experiences an intense arousing impulse to cut open his flesh, to subsequently embed scrap metal. During this cold open, he performs a ritual, slowly inserting a large metal rod into a hole in his leg after admiring photos of Olympic athletes. And the acting sure makes it extra painful, which is really great for me to see and hear. Thank you, Tsukamoto. Once finished, he notices maggots crawling around in his wounds and, like, maybe it's happening, or perhaps it's a hallucination, a metaphor for the shame and guilt of giving into his desires. Who knows? It's left up to your own interpretation, as is everything else that proceeds. Upset by this, he runs out into the night panicking, where he is then hit by a mysterious person, later revealed to be a guy. Simply credited as Salaryman and his, girlfriend. Again, none of the characters have names. Seeking vengeance, the fetishist haunts the Salaryman, possessing him, as he begins experiencing surreal sexual awakening fantasies, mostly kind of definitely homoerotic. He begins noticing pieces of metal protruding out of his skin in the form of acne, because he's gradually mutating into a metal man. Quite literally, dare I say, metal puberty. Like organs begin stop-motion fusing into metallic mechanical parts all over his body, including his penis becoming a power drill. For real, I'm not joking. His body seems to have a mind of its own, and he's obviously quite angered and in distress because of this. For much of the film, the Salaryman is telepathically shown from the perspective of the victim, traumatizing memories of the hit and run via videotape footage and phone calls. Turns out the metal fetishist is actually still alive and also going through a metal creature metamorphosis. Eventually, this all culminates into one final showdown between the two, a little bit of Marvel action, if you will, except with semen, until they ultimately settle the feud to instead join up as one, merge in a loving embrace so that they can take over, corrupting the rest of society until humanity is wiped and all that remains is a machine in a post-industrial world of rust. Oh, shit. And the story concludes with them welding together, forming a giant, grotesque, mechanical penis tank, taking on a new life, less human and more artificial, as the two accelerate into a horrific, dystopian future, resulting from a love of violence and chaos. Honestly, this movie reminded me a lot of the far less appreciated A Nightmare on Elm Street 2, Freddy's Revenge, and I think that's why I admire it so much. This is just its cool Japanese cyberpunk cousin.
You are all my children now.
On a basic level, both are chucked full of weird, surreal, nightmarish imagery, though prominently they feature a lead character undergoing a deep, unpleasant transformation as a way to represent feelings of shame and social pressures to mask one's sexuality during the height of fear and stigmas due to the HIV/AIDS crisis, which around this time was being called the gay disease or gay cancer, and it created a lot of ignorance. And while yes, it's most common amongst gay men, there was a lot of judgment and misconceptions towards how it spreads. Then you look at Tetsuo the Iron Man, a film that embodies several of these concerns and anxieties from the late 80s, where characters spread this metal-like disease, infecting those through simple physical contact, one of the biggest myths that spread a lot of fear and confusion at the time. So in a sense, you can look at it as a monster movie where the monster at the end is a manifestation of this misinformation that ultimately leads to more chaos and greater death for the future. Oh joy. You'll notice while watching Tetsuo the Iron Man that much of the horror experienced due to the nature of the genre of body horror is people rejecting their bodies, desiring something else, and the pain associated with not having control or agency over one's body as it changes and grows, almost personifying how the human body, not to sound too reductive, is sort of similar to a machine or a chemical factory, constantly performing different functions in various ways. Person to person. Sometimes people are fine with these designs or functions. Other times it feels like the designer was perhaps half asleep when assembling the parts and the chemicals got a little mixed up. Regardless, over time we endure a type of wear and tear, slowly deteriorate, and the mechanisms stop functioning. Honestly, there are multiple ways of looking at it and determining what all this means to you. Because ultimately, at the end of the day, Tetsuo the Iron Man was groundbreaking for its kind and is effective for really the pure visceral. It abrasively rattles in and under your skin, making you feel just as disoriented as its central characters. It's also the most metal thing ever on Earth. The atmosphere and especially the sound design are quite unsettling, with the industrial and mechanical banging and scraping of metal helps bring an extra layer of paranoia that won't be for everyone. Not sure if I'd recommend trying to fall asleep watching and listening to this. But it's clear to see why it's become the iconic cult favorite that it has. Not only that, it inspired countless other films in the Japanese cyberpunk scene to go even harder, such as the infamous 964 Pinocchio from 1991, or as it's known in the UK, Screams of Blasphemy, a movie by Shōzen Fukui, who worked as a production assistant on Tetsuo, and yes, it too had just the most bizarre plot ever conceived by a human brain. It's about Pinocchio, you know, good old Pinocchio, the memory-wiped humanoid sex robot raised in a factory who is then thrown out into the dystopian streets of Japan for having erectile dysfunction. Obviously. Then the rest is just screaming and more screaming and vomiting. Just, you'll love it. Also, shock gorilla style. However, it's much longer. Hot take, perhaps could have been trimmed down a tad. It's pure chaos, especially towards the end when they're just running around in public and everyone is confused. As am I. I suggest watching Tetsuo first, and if you can stomach that, you can try 964 Pinocchio. It's always best to start in a shallow end and then go deeper. If not, you could check out the sequels. In 1992, Tsukamoto released Tetsuo 2 Body Hammer, which was less of a continuation and more of an optimized version of what came previously, featuring most of the same cast on a much larger budget. You see, its predecessor was shot on 16mm in black and white, a neat stylistic choice, giving it that vintage grainy effect like the classic Godzilla or King Kong. Additionally, it made the film itself look metal, almost a metallic sheen quality. This one, on the other hand, was shot on 35mm in color. It still involves the same themes and concepts, fears towards a technologically evolving world becoming more capitalized, and the way the working class is dehumanized by corporate higher-ups, seen as a small, replaceable piece meant to keep products coming and going. The same can mostly be said for the third, 2009's Tetsuo the Bullet Man, the one that Trent Reznor of Nine Inch Nails wrote and performed an industrial track for, making this overall one hell of a trilogy, consisting of some of the most inventive, surreal, cyberpunk body horror monster movies like no other. It's certainly one that sticks with you. They sure make Transformers look extremely underwhelming. And the best part is, each person gets a little something different out of each experience, and isn't that great? You never know what to expect, and ain't that fun? So with that said, what do you think of Tetsuo the Iron Man? Hopefully this made processing such a film a little less daunting and make a tiny bit more sense. If you made it this far, might as well leave a like and subscribe to the channel. I mean, what do you have to lose? It's free. All the cool kids are doing it, and so should you. Thank you so much for watching. I appreciate you specifically, out of anyone else, alive or dead. And that's all for now. Goodbye.